Good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for being here. It is my pleasure to talk to you today about how you can expand your blue team by creating a security culture. Before we get started and go too far deep into this, I want to define blue team as your incident response team or the organization that helps defend your employees against outside attackers to make sure we're all on the same page from a definition perspective. But let me tell you a little bit about myself first before we get into it. I've been in the computer security space for 15 years. I started initially with computer forensics, and I've always had a love of security, but I recently, in the last 6 years of my career, fell in love with the human element of security. And what I have found is that this passion for things like behavioral science, positive motivation and psychology, game theory and game design, all these things that help us understand why we as humans love doing what we do, when applied to security, can put out some pretty cool programs and some really great results. And so I'm excited to share a little bit about the programs that I've built. Most recently, I spent 5 years at Salesforce running a team called the Trust Engagement Group that was responsible for creating security culture and secure behaviors for our internal employees, developers and engineers, and for our customers around feature adoption at Salesforce. Just recently, at the end of 2016, I left Salesforce to co-found Elevate Security, which is a startup that's focused on creating secure behaviors in employees based on behavioral science, and a lot of my experience having built this at Salesforce. So let's dive right into this. We all understand that employees can pose a potential risk to organizations. In fact, when CISOs were surveyed by the Corporate Executive Board in 2014, 61 of them said that unauthorized use of employee credentials caused them great concern as one of their top threats. Spear phishing was 72%. And so you see these numbers and you're like, okay, that's not a surprise. I understand that my employees pose risk to an organization. And in a different survey, 50% of CISOs believe that over half of the breaches that they've seen were as a result of insecure behavior. But I would say that number's probably a little bit higher based on my informal survey around this. So not great news, right? We understand that our employees are introducing insecure vulnerabilities in our organization. But there is another side of this conversation that needs to also be looked at, because these same CISOs were also interviewed. And when they found, what they saw was 32% strongly agreed, 32% agreed, that employees are also a source of really great and vital information about breaches and were key to discovering breaches and greater than any other internal process or technology. And so when you look at that, you wonder, why don't we invest in our people more if users have discovered more breaches than any other internal process or technology? There is a golden nugget in here that really needs to be explored a little bit more deeply than we have as an industry. Unfortunately, we don't have a great track record as security professionals around treating our employees with a lot of respect or admiration. We call them things like the problem exists between the keyboard and the chair, the weakest link, we've called them wetware. The problem is the squishy thing between two ears. And this is just some of the nicer stuff that I've heard about users. In fact, we call them users, not even human beings, right? We call them users. So we're coming from a place that I would argue is one of some deficit in treating our employees as full participants in protecting our organization. And so what I would love to do is present to you a slightly different perspective on this and how we can actually use our employees to benefit our organizations. This is a term that I've been using. It's called people-centric security. And what I would like to offer here is the perspective that employees might actually be central to problem solving and securing our organization rather than contributing to them. And we as security professionals and security teams can give employees resources to do this better. And that, in fact, is a key part of our job. Not finding the mistakes they make, but empowering them to help us defend the organization. So let's take a look at what this actually looks like. I'm going to use phishing as this example that runs through this presentation, because it's something that is ubiquitous across industries and across organizations of any sizes. But before we really get too far into this, I want us to have a common language around what we're talking about when we say phishing. There are three ways that attackers will try to exploit an end user to get information out of them. One of them is credential stealing, so stealing someone's username and password. And that requires a human vulnerability. Give me your password. Thank you, now I can log in as you on the site. The second one is running malicious executable on an endpoint. This requires the employee or a human to run the malicious executable, but it also requires a weakness in the technology stack, like an unpatched system. And the third category is clicking on a link. So it requires me as an attacker to convince you as a human being, as an employee, to navigate to a website. So that's the social engineering part. But then it also requires a downstream vulnerability, like a vulnerability in your browser, for example. The reason I wanted to spend a few minutes on the slide is you'll see that if we had perfect technology controls in our world, we don't necessarily need to care about human vulnerability. If we had perfect 2FA implementation, 100% patched systems, and browsers that were never open to vulnerabilities, our employees could click on things however they would like, give out their credentials as much as they want. But that's not the reality we live in. So this is a proposal for a defense in depth approach, because this is actually a layered way of defending your organization. Because yes, you need the technology, but if you empower your people, you're adding another layer of defense around this. So please keep that in mind as we go through this. I'm not suggesting that human beings are the silver bullet, but I would argue that there is no silver bullet for sale on our floor at the RSA Expo or offered to us today. So this is a joint solution for this problem. So how many people in the audience right now have a phishing program that they run against their employees? Okay, I would say probably 90%. And this is a current best practice. And what is the current best practice in our organization or in our industry is that we'll send a phishing email to our employees and see whether or not they'll click on it. And when they do, there's often an educational component that pops up and says, oh no, you've clicked on something you shouldn't have. Let me educate you in real time why that was a mistake. Seems good in theory, right? And the goal of this is to reduce the number of people who click on link by saying, well, you clicked on it, bad on you. Now, there's a couple of problems with this as your metric of success that I want to explore with you. One, I have in my past created phishing tests that were incredibly difficult, and 75% of my organization fell through for it. The next month, I created a phishing test that was remarkably easy, and 10% of it fell for it. Now, did my employees just get smarter? Is my test easier? How do I know that I'm actually having an impact and metric of success on my organization if I can't guarantee that the test that I'm using has a comparable level of difficulty over time? So you have to really make sure that when you're testing your metrics over time, it is an apples to apples comparison of the difficulty of the test. There's some nuances of this that make it considerably harder. For example, I can send a really difficult tax email to my employees in the United States during tax season, and they'll fall for it. But it may not be tax season in Europe. Same test, different geographies, right? Different circumstances. Even the time of day I sent it will make one harder and one easier. So when you say, I dropped my phishing test percentage lower, you need to be asking, is that the correct way of measuring this? Second thing, so now let's say we're comparing apples to apples tests in the same difficulty. Can you say that you aren't pre-notifying your employees of this attack because you're using very similar type of tests as the one before, so they know to look for it? Are you getting smarter, or are you just getting them sensitized to the same test? And the thing that was frustrating for me when I was running this phishing program was, when am I done? It's exhausting to keep emailing people on a regular basis and hitting them over the head. When is it good enough? Well, they say, well, Masha, like when it's 0%. And this is the part where I get to have a spoiler alert. It will never be 0%. And this was a report that came out with a data breach report, Verizon data breach report in 2013. And some researchers put out a whole bunch of different phishing tests, and they found that campaigns with 3 emails sent had a better than 50% chance of getting clicked. Now, campaigns with 10 phishing emails sent had a near guaranteed approach to be clicked. So if I send at least 10 emails, I have a 99.9% chance that somebody's going to click on it. I appreciate the fact that there are different difficulties, right, and this can vary a little bit, but overall not great news. So basically, I need to send out 10 emails to guarantee one person's going to click on it. So what do we do now? I suggest that we plan for failure. And I understand failure, people say failure is not an option. I would say here failure is your only option. And this is the reality that you need to start playing in. And if you assume that click-through rate is a bad, like having anything above click-through rate of zero is a bad metric, I would say you're not living in a real space. And you need to start planning for the fact that your employees are going to be clicking on links. So how do you make the best of that situation? Now, there are three things that will happen when your employees click on a link. One, they have no idea they clicked on a link, right? They just gave out their credentials, and it seemed totally fine that the website was down or redirected, and they'll go about their day as if nothing had happened. Second, they don't care. Something looked weird about that website, but they think, well, there's probably mitigating controls. There's a security team for this. I don't have to care about it because it's not my problem. It's not my job. It's probably not going to be a big deal anyway, and so they go on with their day. The third one is they take corrective actions. They choose to do something about the fact they've made a mistake. And you say, oh yeah, door number three here is obviously the best choice. Unfortunately, that's not actually what we're training our employees on. In fact, the Verizon data breach report in 2016, just last year, said of the sanctioned emails that were sent in and analyzed in this last year's report, only 3% of them were actually alerted to management as potential suspicious emails. So this is not a behavior we're communicating to our employees. So let's talk about door number one and two. What happens when an employee clicks? Right now, if an employee clicks, you'll have an undetected compromised computer. I'm assuming that if this email is getting into your system, it's because it's bypassed your technology stack already. You have a spear phishing attack that has managed to navigate your technology controls. So you have an undetected compromised computer. And now you're relying on your downstream technology controls, your second and third layers of defense at this point, to both block it and to make sure you're mitigating any downstream issues. So you're really hoping 2FA is in place and working. Your antivirus is up to date, right? You have all your systems patched. And you're trying to mitigate the fact that now you have an infected computer. As an incident response team, you are waiting on your technology controls to alert you about the fact now you have malicious activity on your network. And you are waiting on your signatures to trigger and your devices to alert you the fact that you need to start looking into an organization. While you're waiting on that, you're introducing dwell time for an attacker. The longer they're in an organization, the more time they have to leverage and pivot and have a deeper foothold in their organization. So this is your third option, right? Number three. If we train our employees to report phishing emails, whether or not they clicked, the incident response team can start detecting malicious technology or malicious activity that hasn't been caught by our technology stack. And what this does is that if an employee starts sending things to an incident response team, they can start looking at it ahead of time. And what we've done in the past, when I was at Salesforce, we trained our employees to report suspicious activity whether or not they clicked. The success metric here was not whether or not you clicked, it's whether or not you reported it. Whether or not you let us know about the fact that there's something on your system that was potentially malicious. And why this was important was because we really wanted them to check with us as security experts and double check their own instincts. And this is incredibly important because we as organizations don't hire salespeople because they're great security people. They're great at sales. Marketing people are great at marketing. They're not great at security, otherwise they would be here in this room and attending RSA. You're great at security, which is why you're here. It is your job to do security. It is their job to do marketing. It is their job to do sales. It is unrealistic for other people in your organization for them to assume you can do their job excellently. So why do we assume, as security professionals, that everyone else in the organization should have the same level of awareness and knowledge as we, as security people, who are well-versed, read up on this, we attend this conferences and understand the latest and greatest threats. What we ask our employees to do is say, hey, I know you're busy, but if you have a gut instinct that something is not quite right, check with me. Let me know so I can tell you whether or not it's legit or not. It'll take you just a couple of seconds, if you can do it right, and I'll talk about that in a second. And now you'll know. You'll have the safety of understanding that your thing you're about to open is legitimate or not. And so we're training our employees to essentially detect signatures and malicious activity that our technology can't detect. So we're training them to be human intrusion detection systems. So the benefits of reporting. Why does this matter? Well, if a legitimate report gets sent to the incident response team, there's a couple of things that the IR team can do. Whether or not this person has clicked on a link, they can start searching, they can block this malicious traffic to outbound command and control. So if someone else has clicked on the link, they'll be able to prevent that outbound traffic. They can filter malicious emails from other inboxes in the network. They can scan for instances of malware on the network because now they'll have signatures. And they can begin initiating remediation efforts on now known compromised machines if those people have self-reported. But what this will do is it'll reduce the noise in an organization. So an IR team can say, I actually know that there's a legitimate attack worth focusing on here versus this whole iceberg of things that they need to constantly manage. Now, we encourage our end users to report even if they know it's phishing and they don't click. The best outcome of tests and then the behaviors that we try to reinforce is, I sent you a test, you didn't click on it, so you didn't infect your computer, and then you also let me, the incident response team, know, thereby preventing any of your other peers from getting infected as well. And this is really important because you only need one person to let your incident response team know that a malicious attack is happening in order to protect everybody else who just got that link. So you're trying to no longer educate everybody to be correct all the time. You just need to get it right with one intelligent, paranoid employee. And one employee can then save the company from an ongoing large-scale attack. And this is important because now you have a whole different metrics of success. And I would say that 20% reporting rate is what you can define as a win. And the way that I got to 20% was, well, if one person in every 10 is all an attacker needs to click on a link to get infect a machine and get a foothold, then I need one in every 10 people to report. Two for redundancy in case that email gets lost somewhere. So 20%. If 20% of every single one of my tests, regardless of difficulty, targeted spear phishing or your standard e-greeting, at least 20% gets reported to my incident response team, I know that I have coverage across all of my attacks, and that is the behavior I continuously reward. Now, I want to tell you an anecdote about what happened while we rolled this program out at Salesforce. There is an organization that's a red team. We had 5 full-time pen testers on board, and they spent a month developing custom malware to get into the organization, which is great. It's part of their job. And in the past, they had sent people phishing emails, convinced them to click on it, said, I'm from IT, and then they were off. What they started seeing is when they started emailing, even 10 people, their custom malware was beginning to get reported in a very short period of time to our incident response team. And it no longer became economically feasible for them to continue phishing our employees. They just spent a month of custom malware, and their chances of that custom malware getting to the hands of the blue team was too high for them to risk it just by sending it out. And so they really had to change their attack vector from that perspective. And so essentially, we made it way more expensive for our employees to get phished, which is not to say someone didn't click on it, but it was no longer an enjoyable proposition from an attacker's perspective. So all this is great, but how do we maximize reporting? Because we still need one person to report. And we're talking about something that's particularly delicate here, which is reporting in the face of failure. So how do we make sure that our employees, when they make a mistake, say, I've made a mistake and I trust that you will be kind to me about it? That is a really delicate conversation. I don't know if any of you have kids, but that's not something that happens that often either. I mean, even as adults, taking blame is not a comfortable conversation. So how do we roll this out programmatically so that we can actually make benefit of this behavior? So this is a question I really like asking people to self-reflect on you as a security organization. Do you feel like people in your organization see you as a tax accountant that will help you with your taxes before your taxes are due and are beneficial to your return statement? Or are you more like the IRS, who will also come after your taxes, but a much more authoritatively with a policing agency? So are you a helpful resource or a policing agency? And it's not entirely what you think you are, but how do other people in your organization see you as a security team? Will they feel comfortable going to you as a resource? So there are a couple of things that if you are seen as an IRS-like equivalent, you're missing out on a couple of really important conversations. Your employees won't find it safe to admit failure. You are minimizing the amount of proactive, voluntary interactions that people in your organization can come to you and say, hey, like, this just looks a little weird. Can you help me check it out? Your employees may not come to you because of fear of retribution or having to take the responsibility of identifying that big issue. And lastly, you know, they just might filter out your messages. You're sending them emails or newsletters and say, oh, it's again from the security team, put into the spam folder, right? So they're not interested in having this dialogue with you. So you can start seeing some of the really valuable insights as a security team that you're missing out if you don't have a productive, working, safe relationship with your employees. So I want to tell you a little bit of a research study that I found to be incredibly impactful. Dr. Gottman was a Harvard professor, and in 1994, he conducted a study with 700 couples. He interviewed them for 15 minutes, and in 15 minutes, he was able to predict with a 94% likelihood who was going to get divorced in 5 years and who was going to stay married. And the way he did that was by couples who had 5 positive interactions to every 1 negative were the ones that stayed married. They've done this type of analysis on highly productive teams, and they found managers who gave their employees feedback, 5 positive pieces of feedback to every 1 negative, had the most highest functioning performing teams of any other parts of the organization. So this applies in both relationships as well, and in personal relationships as well as work relationships. I would like to present the idea that this may also work for relationships at scale. How many positive relationships do you have as a security team with your employees in your organization? Do you regularly say, thank you so much for reporting that email. You totally nailed that. Thank you for wearing your badge visibly. That's exactly what you're supposed to do. And this month, we didn't have anybody tailgate behind us and giving them thumbs up. And how often do you punish them for bad behavior? Is there a 5-to-1 ratio? There are a couple of ways you can start putting out 5 regular touch points to your employees, and it doesn't have to be really big heavy lifts. So we had a gamification point system, which I'm going to talk a little bit, but can you give out points and recognition when people do positive things that you want to reinforce? Leaderboards of people who've been top reporters, for example, of a particular spear phishing or finding and closing the highest number of bugs of different criticalities. You can give out t-shirts, hats, stickers. Our incident response team, our red team at Salesforce, would create branded t-shirts and stickers whenever they would do a red team readout, and everyone who was affected by that red team readout would get the sticker as like a sign of like a badge, a tattoo of like, I survived this hack, right? And we're able to bond over and say, yeah, this organization is safer because we went through this experience. And so there are positive associations with our security team engagements. Company-wide announcements, so having someone in a position of authority say, this person did an amazing job around security, and this is something we really care about, and thank you emails. So this is a snapshot of the gamification program that I built while I was at Salesforce. Happy to talk about this a little bit more in depth, but at a high level, we just gave out trust points for key behaviors that we really wanted to recognize, some of the things that I mentioned. And different points added up to different levels of expertise, right? You get a t-shirt at level 2, you get a hoodie at level 3, we taught a lock-picking class at level 4. And so people are like, this is amazing that my security team gives me t-shirts and lockpicking, and like, this is a relationship I want to continue having. And all of this seems fun, but the goal of this ultimately is to ensure that we had a working relationship with people in the organization, and they didn't see us as the enemies. There was safety in admitting failure. So I want to talk a little bit of what results of this program look like. So while we did this at Salesforce, we found that in the first 6 months of driving awareness around reporting rates, we saw an increase of 350% of reports to our incident response team. We knew it was going to go up, so we planned for this accordingly, and I'll tell you a little bit how we did that in a second. But we also saw way more false positives. People just got more paranoid and said, hey, like, I think this survey is a phishing email. And we said, no, that's our marketing team poorly formatting it. I'm sorry. Like, we shouldn't do that, right? Which began a different conversation around how do we make sure we trust internal communications. We did notice that people started sending us things that weren't phishing emails, but we chose specifically to accept those as the cost of being able to see actual reports that we missed otherwise. By knowing that we were going to be investing in higher reporting rates, we also invested in automation. Some of the things that we focused on was an auto response. Before I send out a test, for example, we just had an auto response that said, if any emails come in that match this link, you can auto respond and say, thank you so much, you actually caught a phishing test, please keep this quiet until so other people can have a chance to report it. Or, thank you so much for reporting this. This was not a phishing test, but we're already aware of it. Thank you. Or, thank you so much for reporting this. We haven't seen this before. We'll get back to you within 10 minutes to let you know. We also focused on reducing our SLA, so our response time, so people would find it work appropriate in a business context to check with us and wait 10 minutes while we got back to them and say, yeah, it's legit or not. Click it or don't, right? And so they were willing to, they were experiencing a little bit of a lag in clicking some of their more contentious emails. So both automation and investing in an IR team. So some of the things that we started seeing, these are snapshots of key behaviors that we rolled out as campaigns to our employees, but as we were training our employees to report anything, these were some of the reports we got, right? Hey, someone just badge surfed tailgated onto our main floor. So we started seeing things way beyond just phishing, right? So we started seeing reports of physical security. We saw things that were not relevant. I lost my sweater on the subway and said, sorry about your loss, we can't help you with that, right? Is this email really from American Express? Yes, it is, you should probably pay your bills. And the last one is, my mouse cursor's moving by itself. We're like, that's probably an issue for IT, we can redirect you there. But then every once in a while, through all of this noise, we get things like, my browser proxy settings were changed and I didn't change them. And this, for example, was the first report that led us to understanding an internal red team attack that had been going on and had bypassed all of the fancy technologies that we had. It was a very sophisticated attack, and it wasn't until an employee pointed our incident response team to the right direction that we were really able to start pivoting and rolling out our response to that. So what I would like to leave you with around this is three key components. First of all, start communicating to your employees about the importance of reporting. Clicking and reduction of clicking is important in that it reduces the cleanup cost of your organization, and I appreciate that can be a headache. But reporting is arguably a more vital behavior to focus on than just click-through rates. And making sure that you measure both of those as part of your campaign so you can see the impact of your work. What you'll probably see is while your phishing click-through rates are all over the place, depending on difficulty, you will see a steady and gradual increase in your reporting rates over time. And that is a measurable trend where you can say, I can prove that my employees are getting it. They're more aware, they're more interactive, they have a more ongoing relationship with the security team. Focus on building a positive relationship with your employees early, before you need them to report. Because if you need them to report failure, and it's the first time you're being nice to them, it's way too late. So invest in that relationship before you ever actually need to use it. Consider using positive reinforcement as part of your ongoing campaigns. Consider what you punish your employees for and see if there is a corollary positive incentive that you can do for them. There's just a lot of things in our organization where like, this is the compliance in our industry. This is the compliance regulations, and if you don't do this, you'll get fired, there'll be issues around it. But what is the positive of that? What if someone does above and beyond job around that? How can you recognize that kind of work for an organization? And and as a long-term lesson, consider what else you can do to turn your employees into human intrusion detection systems. How can you fine-tune that as a signature that feeds back into your security team so you're having a better pulse of what's going on in your organization that your technology stack can't catch? And understanding that when you move your employees' awareness from a have-to to a want-to, you're driving their mindset into a totally new level of engagement. Any questions? If you can go to a mic, so we can hear you. Thank you.
Only one thing. No incident occurred annually.
Say that one more time.
No incident. No. Yeah, it's a quick incident. It's so, occurred annually. No?
I'm not quite sure.
How many incidents occurred annually?
How many incidents occurred after this program launched?
Yeah.
I can't say that publicly, but as you can tell, nothing made the press, so I can. Quite honestly, we found that any phishing attacks that actually hit our inboxes were reported with less than a minute of mm-hmm. being in our inbox system. So we were able to stay ahead of every phishing attack and spear phishing that was able to.
And also one other thing is that basically is a gamification program, but is it still training for other method or especially your psychology is very important for the awareness and mm-hmm. the things.
Yeah, so if I understand correctly, is there other elements of psychology or just gamification that's important? So gamification works because it is designed on game theory, which gets people to want to do something, not because they have to. And there's a really great book called Reality is Broken, and it packs on the things that make a great game are feedback, autonomy, mastery, and social a social component, which are all components of a really great program. It says, how well did you do? Can you have the opportunity to do better? Do your peers recognize you? So you can take elements of game design and apply it to things outside of the program. And so there's a lot of overlap between positive psychology and game design. They're just different terms for very similar things that motivate people to want to do something. Okay. So very, very similar
Thank
works.
You. Mm-hmm.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for the presentation. I work in a risk management team for a big company, and basically we We have a topic only for humans on the risk management, on the risk assessments we run. And we actually, my question is more related to how do you get a leadership commitment and as well as legal, especially because sometimes we have some barriers or roadblocks to actually run some type of tests.
Phishing tests?
Yeah, I do. I like to do a lot of social engineering tests.
Yeah.
But sometimes I have a roadblock in legal and the leadership.
Yeah.
How could you get, or your tips to get leadership commitment or legal commitment for those?
I've definitely seen that in a couple of organizations. The organizations that I've seen this, it's because the leadership doesn't want to be put into an embarrassing position. They don't want to be shown like, oh, you fell for it. I would start with your high value users, people who have privileged account access and say, point to actual attacks that have happened to similar types of users and explain that you're gonna do phishing tests for a subset of users. And if you can show metrics over time, you can also then take those metrics of success and apply to other organizations. I've also found running incident response teams saying, okay, so your people have fallen for it, so let me show you why a remediation effort is necessary. My experience is that you're trying to get over the emotional fear of getting shamed, which is a really scary thing for not only anybody, but as an executive. So making sure that you don't call out maybe people by name and say, I will keep the data anonymized. Yeah. And this is not only an opportunity for finding failure, but also recognizing people who are really great at reporting. So giving people an opportunity to shine is another great reason to run a phishing test to see who's doing an excellent job. So making sure you're not just using it as a negative punishment.
Okay, and just to complement that piece, it's the legal side of the equation. So how about actually onboard attorneys to the idea that you're going to, in quotes, expose people to some situations where we might have some.
So you should check with your legal counsel, but given the fact that there are thousands of organizations that are running this, and my own legal counsel, there's no issues that from
shouldn't
a legal
be.
Perspective.
Okay.
And if they tell you otherwise, I would double check that.
Okay.
I don't know how much they'll love that, but as long as you are able to phish people who are in your employee base and in your domain, make sure you don't phish your contractors or make sure it goes out of your email domain because you do not have legal rights to that, probably.
Awesome.
Mistake I've made before. and making sure that you phish without using other people's brands. So I'll give you, I accidentally phished my first time with FedEx, and my employees started reporting it to FedEx's security team. And the CISO of FedEx called the CISO of Salesforce and said, what are you doing? And so we had to back off from there. So that was another lesson learned. So making sure that you don't do brand damage to other people's brands and making sure that you email people who are in your authorized domain name, so as your employees in your organization, you should be good to go.
Thanks so much.
You're welcome.
Just two quick things. What did you use at Salesforce as your primary reporting tool, especially for emails?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's a great question. We just set up a dedicated security hotline, so it's security@salesforce.com. I know organizations that have browser plugins or buttons. We weren't standardized on one browser, so that was a tricky thing for us to do. In a perfect world, I would love to do a big red button that says just report. In order for this to be effective, it's really important to point out that you have to have a really clear message around where and how employees should report. We didn't give anybody points or credits if they reported it to phishing@Salesforce or trust@Salesforce, it's to one email to make sure that we got it and nothing else counted. And it took some time and practice, but one of the reasons our reporting rates also got up is because our messaging got really clear around where and how people need to report, which is a really key component to this equation as well.
Okay, and the other thing is what do you find to be the most or some of the most effective methods of pre-training people, of engaging people ahead of time, like brown bags or sending out videos or emailing materials, which of course gets kind of innocuous after a while?
I don't actually think you should pre-train them. I would argue that a lot of people are already sensitized to phishing more than you'll give them credit for. And just by running a test and then depending on how they do, letting them know and then course correcting, because if they've reported it already, they already passed your final exam, and then you'll have a subset of people who may not, and they might need some additional training. But I would spend your pre-training budget and time on the people who haven't passed. And so you're respecting people who already know it. And I'm a big fan of giving the right content to the right people at the right time. And so test them first, because they might already pass the final exam. And then just focus on the people who are left.
So would you see any value to offering like a voluntary lunch and learn type thing? Hey, come and ask questions. Mm-hmm. We can talk about some of these things.
I would fish them first to drum attention to the fact that now they can learn about it. Because people will be like, oh, I guess I would actually run a really hard test. I would get a whole bunch of people to fail, and I would use those failure rates as a segue into my lunch and learn.
Nice.
Use the fact that you can adjust the numbers to your benefit.
I like it. Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
I was curious, recently at the town hall, in my company, senior vice president of HR gave us a shout out for our phishing campaigns.
Cool.
Because his surveys weren't getting answered because people thought they were phishing campaigns. So I was curious.
Yeah.
Not very good attention, right?
Been there.
I was curious if you have any strategies or techniques to reduce false positives and help people know what's internal and what's not internal.
Yeah. The way we solved this, and by no means was this a perfect solution, was legitimate emails that were going to be sent out by our organization had to be sent in advance to our incident response team. So same thing with our automated case response. If they knew it was a legitimate survey, they would just auto-respond and say, this is a legit survey, please go ahead and fill it out. And it didn't require man hours to do that. So not only would I send the phishing test in advance to the incident response team so they could auto-respond on the phishing test, but we started asking anyone who was sending out an email to greater than 200 people in our organization to pre-send that email with a link, for example, right, to our incident response team. So they could just set an auto-response and said, thanks for checking, this is legitimate. So we were still reinforcing that behavior. Check with us and we'll let you know one way or the other. We also asked that people posted the email with username on our intranet site. And if people wanted to check out of band whether or not it was phishing, there was one known, known official communications and all emails that went out. Who sent it, when was sent it, just a screenshot there. So if people wanted to double check out of band, they could do it.
So you actually have a website where you actually had the internal communications and when it was going
to
be sent?
I have to say probably 40% of the people who sent it out would post stuff, so it wasn't 100% of them, but it was better than nothing. So those are the two ways we started reducing some of that. But that was still an ongoing thing. It'd be great just internally sign emails if we could just done that.
Got you.
Last question.
All right. You talk a lot about positive reinforcement.
Yeah.
What do you do with like your gamification when a user that has master level status does something really stupid? Do you take it away?
You put
leaderboard up there as a possibility. Doesn't that dropping on the leaderboard or dropping off, isn't that a negative reinforcement? Yeah. How does that tie in with the positive reinforcement that you're talking about?
We chose not to take away points. We'd let them expire over time, but we chose not to publicly shame. The way that we would address issues like that is by going up to them and remediating after the fact. But I would check why they did that. I mean, if they're someone who clearly has invested a lot of time and energy in security, there might be reasons why they did it. So that's a really interesting use case for you as a security team to understand, because training and awareness is probably not going to help. The person has maxed out everything you've offered, right? There's got to be something else. Maybe they didn't have the tools or the resources. Maybe they're malicious, right? Which might be a reason to escalate to HR, right? But that's way beyond, point system and leaderboard, right? That's something you should handle one-on-one.
All right, thank you.
Absolutely, yeah. All right, thank you very much for your attention. Please send me emails.